You how to use an LSTM to do predictive analytics on equipment failures. Okay, so here's the site, and got it from this particular site talking about predictive maintenance. The idea behind predictive maintenance is if you can predict when equipment is going to fail based on some sensory information, then you may be able to save money. So in this case, what I'm doing is I'm going to cycle through and get my ops sets, and then I'm going to get my sensory measurements. I'm going to put that into a data frame, and then predictive maintenance techniques are used to determine the condition of equipment to plan maintenance failure ahead of its time. So that's the idea, because maintenance failures and downtime on equipment could be very costly. So knowing when equipment could fail ahead of this time may save you money. Predicting failure of the machine in the upcoming days. So the sensors are telling you that there's a problem. The length of the runs varies from 128 cycles to 356. Okay, so how do we do it? Find the max cycle count for each unit. We'll group by unit number, cycle, and cycle field, get the max, put it in a data frame, add the columns, and then what I'm going to do is calculate my remaining useful life as the max minus the current cycle, and then I'll feed that into a LSTM array, which works a lot like sequence to sequence. It just takes a block of time series data. You determine that size by your look back value, and it creates a array, and then you feed that array as input into your network. Okay, so let's look at the function that does that. GenTrain, pass in the data frame, the length, and the sequence columns. So what that will do then is we'll take the data frame and get its values. Then we'll set the number of elements that are in there by shape one, which will be the number of rows. And then we'll zip that together and create then a overlap. We'll change the array structure. And so now your time series is looking back a certain number of units, and it's creating a three-dimensional view of your data. And then with the target, you're creating a one-dimensional view of your data, and so then that creates the sequence. So what I'm doing here is I'm going to get my X columns. I'll normalize my data between minus one and one. Then I'll fit transform the data, and that will become the new values for my DF train. Then I'll concatenate, I'll do my generate here. And for each unit, I will create my sequence values, and I'll create my list of the list, and then that'll build my X train. And X train will then have the dimensions. In this case, what I'm going to do is I'm going to change that to a smaller number. I've changed my X units to 10. I'll fit it. So I'm running my epochs now, and it'll start kicking off. You'll see the training loss. It's going to run real fast because I've done smaller units. What I did is I wanted to go with a smaller look back. It was originally 50, but LSTMs have the ability to learn from its time series in the back, and so it was too far back in its memory. So I decided to shorten up its memory a little bit, keep it more relevant maybe to the last 10 or so time series for each unit or each engine. So it's calculating, predicting on each engine, and now it's as you can see, doing the smaller algorithm looking back, it's not quite as good. It's not got quite as good in its match. So maybe going to 50 was a better choice, but it, let's go back to here. Let's see, where is that? It's gonna be right here. Instead of 10, let's go back up to 50. I'll change that to 50, run it. My look back, that's how far back in the time series that we're gonna be training on. You can see now that it's 15,000 rows, 17 features, and I'm looking back on the time series, 50 steps back in my sequence. I've got 116,000 parameters. I'll run my fit. It should still run pretty fast because my model size is pretty small. I did have it at originally at 512 and 256, and it was running kind of slow because there's so many neurons in the network. So we're going with a little bit faster model. Okay, there goes our first training epics coming up. What you're seeing over on the right side is the loss, mean square error, and we'll evaluate it here, and that'll give us a total. If you bear with me, we'll see the effect of the look behind. The LSTM is a really nice model for time series because it learns from the previous sequence. And so you have these overlapping sequences, similar to sequence to sequence. So you're just moving down the line one step at a time. You're looking back, in this case, 50 units, and then advancing through the time series like a window. So it works very similar to windowing, and then that input is overlaid in the LSTM network as an input layer, and so it learns from the hit past. It has forget gate, so it figures out what to ignore, and then it has the long-term memory where it's just passing on to other neurons, which makes it very effective. Okay, we'll look at the mean square error. Looks good. Let's look at our evaluation. Hopefully that's down around 700. We'll see that in just a moment. Okay, still pretty high. So again, I've had it down around the 700 where my error was pretty low. And let's take a look. Yeah, it's just not getting those areas up in here. So what I did before is I used a higher neuron count, and I was able to get up into these regions up in this area here. Okay, well, that's a recap of, I'm going to do a quick recap of showing you how to import your data for sensor data, how to predict using time series, the remaining useful life, and a few thoughts on how to deal with data that seems to vary.